Hi folks, let's turn and machine this Mitsubishi Evo sculpted shift lever. Three lessons out of this video. Number one, using the Fusion 360 sculpt environment for real world, pretty cool applications. Number two, work holding. And number three, the trick in Fusion to create this really good looking fake knurling. Welcome to another Wednesday widget. Starting off with a 2-inch piece of 6061 T6 aluminum for some relatively basic lathe OD turning and profiling. Then we'll flip it over using some copper shims to keep the four-jaw chuck from marring into our part and dialing in that runout. And then starting with a parting op, that's going to part off the extra material that was serving as our work holding in the prior turning op, and then turning that final outside fillet. So hit pause and take a look at this part. The good news is we've got this hole. That's how the shift lever will mount in the vehicle. How do we make use of that as a way of holding on to this part to do this profiling in the mill and then adding the knurling? This is what Daniel came up with. So we've got a 246 block that's lifting the part up off of the machine table. It doesn't actually have to be that high off the table, but it doesn't hurt either. And we had to add this parallel on top of the 246 block only because this is a very peculiar to us thread size, an M10 by 1.25. So we bought a bolt off McMaster, but it was too short to fit through the 246 block. So the parallel helps us use a shorter bolt because we had to add this spacer right here. And that spacer pushes the back side of our part further off the 246 block. That way we've got room to come in and do some surfacing on that inside edge. Finally, using a dial indicator and sweeping that part in, and then also using the dial indicator to make sure that we preload but do not add too much pressure with the toe jack as a means of increasing the work holding stability for this machining op. Speaking of that, we're starting off with a 3D adaptive. We're using a 1/4-inch end mill here with a 45 thou degree radius. So that makes it a proper bullnose that we can do surfacing with. Roughing out with all the RPMs we've got, that's about 650 surface feet per minute at 2/1000ths of an inch feed per tooth. And you can hear that this is definitely a compromised work holding solution. We would benefit from having a bit more rigidity. Using the toe jack will preload the end of our part, and that can really help increase the stability. But the problem is the interaction between the end mill and the part is such that the part is trying to cause the end mill to be pulled out of the machine, and vice versa, the end mill is trying to lift that part up. So this toe jack doesn't really do much at all to help us, especially when we're cutting with more of the side of the tool. Reducing the radial engagement or slowing the cut down can often help with this, but a better solution that I realized after we were done, and I'm kicking myself for not thinking of it, would have been to effectively duplicate our setup with the 246 block on the right-hand side of the part using something like a 1/2-inch or 12-millimeter bolt, and you could put a little rubber or brass end stop on it and squeezing against this end. It wouldn't mar it, and you'd be providing direct support in line with our part that would give it true vertical stability. With the adaptive out of the way, let's use the Fusion 360 3D parallel toolpath to put on that fake knurling. Here's what that toolpath looks like. We're using a 3/16 inch ball end mill. Normally when we do surfacing work, I like to use larger diameter end mills, 1/4-inch, maybe even 3/8 of an inch, because the larger radius or diameter of that tool reduces the scallop height for a given step over. But here, we actually want a relatively small tool to create that knurling effect. So that knurling effect is what's gonna help give us some good grip on this shifter, as well as a cosmetic or aesthetic look to it. And on that note, let's go back to the question of how did we make this model? Card here to the video done by Scott Moyse. Scott's super active on the Autodesk forums, promoting and pushing Inventor and HSM Works and Fusion 360. He lives in New Zealand and he runs a channel called CADPRO CAM Australia and New Zealand. He does a really good job of walking through some very practical elements, tips and tricks to using the Sculpt environment. And again, what I like about it is it's something I can relate to as a machinist or as a car person for the end use product. And speaking of Australia and New Zealand, we've had some requests, so we might try to make a trip back there in 2019. We went to Sydney last year and had a great time. So head on over to NYCCNC, click on Contact Us. If you scroll down to events, we always keep this page updated for trips that we've got planned where you've got the chance to come meet us or see us or speeches or talks that we're doing. If we do end up planning a trip to Australia or New Zealand for next year, we'll make sure we've got it listed here. So how do we create that toolpath? It's actually super easy. 3D, parallel, I'm going to pick my tool, that 3/16 ball end mill, and believe it or not, just click OK. That's not what we want, but we're close. You can see right now the passes are going straight left to right. We want this, so we want them to go at an angle. So I'll right click, edit that toolpath. Under passes, we'll say pass direction. This is relative to your X axis. So I'm gonna type in 45 degrees, click okay. That's gonna cause that pass to happen at 45 degrees. Now this would only do half the trick. To get that full knurled effect, right click, edit, passes, add perpendicular passes. You can adjust the step over. I would recommend checking smoothing to get better motion profile out of your CNC machine, but this is all it takes. And again, you can adjust that step over depending on the knurling effect that you want, as well as the tool diameter. You can also see if you compare this one to the one that Daniel created, his is a little bit deeper down. And the way he did that was he actually went back into the CAD environment, created a sketch. And that sketch is what this green box is. It's both wider in Y, but a little bit narrower in X. And that was to help keep the end mill off of our fixturing and also control the aesthetic look of the part. But it's awesome because it's just that easy. And you can do this on complex 3D shapes as well as simple 2D flat shapes or single angled or beveled surfaces to get a really nice look and to help with actual functionality and grip of a product. Before we were done, we used an end mill just to clean up the sides and kind of help blend that in. It's probably the one weakness or criticism of this part that I would have is it doesn't have that perfect blend. You could do a better job with that if you put it on a simultaneous fourth. And we did think about doing that, but it just seems so much more interesting and a better workholding example to show this being made on a traditional three-axis machine. So folks, hope you've learned something. Hope you enjoyed. Take care. See you next Wednesday.